I did not even know anything about being born again. I didn't even know what sin was. And that's exactly what he made known to me. If you had died in your sins, you would have been plunged right into hell.
Hi, I'm Reverend Steve Millar, a minister here at Grace Cathedral, and this is my lovely wife, Kathy. On today's program, we have a longtime member from Grace Cathedral joining us, and she's going to share some wonderful miracles that she has received, along with how God changed her life.
Welcome to the program, Bernice. We're so happy to have you with us today.
Thank you for having me. It's a great joy to be here today.
Now, how long have you been a member of Grace Cathedral?
Approximately 30 years.
30 years?
Yes.
And what was your life like before you came to Grace Cathedral? Can you share that with us?
I'd be more than happy to. I was born in Alabama. I did not know anything about living free from sin, being born again, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the denomination that I attended. It wasn't taught there, so I did not know. So I didn't know anything. After coming here to Grace Cathedral through circumstances to be with my family, I attended Grace Cathedral, and that was through a babysitter that told me about Grace Cathedral, and she brought me here to Grace Cathedral, the church on Cannon Road.
And what was that like when you came to your first service at Grace Cathedral?
I had never in my life experienced such wonder and grace like that. I never had. The singing, the anointing, the presence of God was there. It was just amazing. Different.
Did you know about Reverend Angley at all, or did you ever hear about him?
I had never heard about Reverend Angley. Okay. Never heard about him.
So your babysitter just told you about coming to church?
Well, what happened was I worked at a job that was near Grace Cathedral on Cannon Road. And as I would pass the church at night going back and forth, there was a huge cross that sat in the center of the ground at, out on Canton Road. And from this, it was a fountain in front of it, and it poured forth different, it was water that poured forth different, it was colors that lit up. And that was amazing to me, and that drew me. And so I asked the babysitter about it, and the church, of course, and she agreed to take me.
I believe that was the hand of God that he drew you just by seeing that fountain.
Yes.
Because I remember when I was in my 20s and I was a sinner, I wasn't saved, I would drive by the church and the big angel statue would draw me. And wow. I'd always slow down so I could catch a glimpse of that angel there in the memorial garden. So I believe the Lord uses those images to draw.
And those colors really amazing. I was astounded by the colors, you know, and I wanted more, you know.
So you walked in, and what happened next?
Well, the anointing, the presence of God, you know, was in that church. It was something different about it. And I had never went to a church or experienced that before, you know. And also the truth that went forth from the pulpit. Reverend let us know that we were to take our Bibles and you take everything to the Word of God, and everything was there just as he said it was.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned growing up that you weren't taught living free from sin. Were you taught the born-again experience?
I did not even know anything about being born again. I didn't even know what sin was. I did not know what sin was, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the works of the flesh, basically.
So when you say that you were in the works of the flesh, you were sinning, and you came into church,
mm-hmm.
when did you receive salvation, and how did that come about?
Well, through the Word of God, the truth that was pouring forth. Reverend let us know that the soul that sinneth shall die, you know, and there's a living, burning hell. Some people don't believe that, but it's true. The Word of God let us know that, you know, with sin. You cannot enter heaven. You won't even see the face of God. And in God's word also, he let us know that, you know, the manifestation of the sins that are listed in Galatians chapter 5, mm-hmm. those sins, you know, if it's shacking up or relationships or sex outside of marriage, God says that, you know, you're dying, go to hell. And there's other manifestation of those 17 of works of the flesh in Galatians also.
Yes.
It could be drinking, mm-hmm. smoking, whatever it is, you know.
Right.
And it doesn't take all those sins to send a soul to hell, just one sin, because God cannot look upon it,
That's
you know.
Right.
And when the word of God was preached at Grace Cathedral, it really changed my life. It really did. I decided to give my whole heart to the Lord and live for him. You know, and if you think about it, I can tell anyone out there, if you're in any of those sins, you think about it, is your soul worth that sin or that person or whatever you're into? Because God can set you free. And he says in his word, you know, in 2 Corinthians, you know, 5, you know, he let us know that, you know, that you can be set free, but you have to give your whole heart to the Lord.
Right, and you didn't have that reality until you came to Grace Cathedral and heard the truth. Just think, you were just going through life.
Motions.
Yep, sinning, and you didn't know that you could plunge into hell at any time.
But you know, once I got saved, God gave me a greater reality of that, and that's exactly what he made known to me. If you had died in your sins, you would have been right. You would have been plunged right into hell. You know, and it's not a place of just... Oh, bliss, you know, just darkness, where your soul will be tortured, you know, with fire and brimstone forever and ever, you know.
I think people don't realize that they need to accept Jesus Christ in their heart. Jesus died on the cross, and he's our Savior, mm-hmm. you know. But if you're going to, you know, just live a life of sin and don't accept Jesus Christ and don't know about the born-again experience, there's still no excuse. You will end up in hell.
And the Bible has a lot of thou shalt not, so a lot of people shy away from that. But it's more than that. It's a reality of the divine blood that Jesus shed on Calvary. And they have to accept that, you know. And some people think that, you know, because part of my life, I think, well, there's a lot of thou shalt not. But the Bible is there as a warning unto us. It's a warning to all who would come to the Lord, you know. And that's the reason why he had the divine blood sacrifice, so whosoever will, they could come to him.
That's right.
You know, I'm just grateful. And I know if he saved my soul, he can save anyone's soul, you know. It's not worth your soul to be burned in hell for all eternity. It's mm-hmm. not worth it.
And some people think that they can't give up their sinful lifestyle, that they have to, you know, just try to do better and they're going to be okay. Mm-hmm. But with a born-again experience, that changes everything. That wipes everything out. And then you have a new life in Christ.
Yes.
And that life is so beautiful and wonderful. And then you realize you were missing out when you were in sin in that wonderful life.
Because I can honestly say this, the world doesn't have no pull on me.
Amen.
It doesn't have a pull. I mean, you die to yourself, you die to the world, you know, so the world has no effect on you at all, mm-hmm. you know, so I'm thankful to God for that.
So you became a new creature in Christ when you accept Jesus into your heart.
And the word of God let us know, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things are new. And that is exactly what happened to me.
So after you received Jesus into your heart, uh-huh. did you go on to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost?
Yes, I did, because at Grace Cathedral, it's taught here, it's a must. It's not an option to anyone who is born again and living free from sin. They encourage you to go to the altar. I was encouraged to go to the altar. And there, the word is glory. That's glorifying God. You have a lot to glorify God for, a lot to be thankful for. You're praising God for his sacrifice on Calvary, the divine blood that he shed for, to wash away all our sins, you know, and put them on a sea of forgiveness. And he never remembers them anymore. And you can't let people or the world condemn you or whatever. Once you give your heart to the Lord, God can, he can do what no other can do.
Yes.
He can be what no other can be. in the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he came in, he changed my tongue. It's not you speaking, it's the Holy Ghost that speaks through you, you know. And I received that experience. It was a wonderful experience. Such joy, such peace, like never before.
It is amazing. It is a supernatural experience when the Holy Ghost comes in and takes over your tongue and speaks in a heavenly language. There's nothing quite like it.
Yes, and it's not you speaking, it's the Holy Spirit speaking through you.
Yeah.
And I think people need to realize that, you know, it's, you know, he is a real person and he wants to live and dwell on the inside of
just
you.
Just like in the book of Acts, Acts 2:4 says, you know, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance.
Yes.
So it is the Spirit.
The Spirit
Father, Son,
gives
and Holy
the
Ghost
utterance.
Wants to live in inside. Right. He gives the utterance.
Yes.
He changed. You know your voice. Anyone know their voice from this, you know, from they know their voice from the Spirit of, you know, God. He wants to live within. So,
yes. Well, I'm so glad that the Lord drew you from Alabama to Ohio to be a part of our Grace family. But we do need to take a quick break. And when we come back, you can share some of your wonderful miracles that the Lord has performed in your life. So, friends, stay with us. We're going to be right back.
I was diagnosed with diabetes for about 10 years. I had diabetes and I suffered with that. I was on 2 insulins and also medication. I went for prayer. When I came back, the test results showed that the A1C level was normal. The doctor was not surprised. She was astonished at that.
Michael from Akron, Ohio shares this testimony. I was diagnosed with diabetes and also a liver problem. Instantly after prayer, I knew I had my miracle from the Lord. I could not wait to go back for more tests because I knew the Lord had moved. Within a couple of weeks, the test confirmed I was healed.
Before we continue the interview with Bernice, we're over here on our Christmas set, and we have a little teaser about Christmas all year long.
And we have with us the writer and director, Gene Giles. Welcome. We're so glad to have you with us.
Thank you.
Now, can you share with our audience what this production is about?
Oh, it's such an exciting play. The children are so excited to take part in it. This play is about a group of children who absolutely love Christmas. The only thing is they're a little sad because it seems like the Christmas season comes and goes so quickly. And they just wish Christmas could last all year long. And they're outside and they're having this conversation about Christmas. And a neighbor lady comes by and she overhears what they're saying. Well, now she is a child of God, and she knows the true meaning of Christmas. And so she decides to invite the children to her church because there's going to be a Sunday school play, Christmas play, and she knows that if they come, that they will learn the true meaning of Christmas.
Well, so. It sounds wonderful and exciting. And are the children all participating in different roles? What are some of those roles?
Oh, yes. We have now the group of children that I was talking about. I call them the snow kids because they're outside playing in the snow. But then we have other children doing other roles. Of course, we have Mary and Joseph, and we have the wise men. And one little boy told me, now he's 9 years old, and he told me, all these years, I've never gotten to be a wise man. This year I'm a wise man. So he's so excited. And it's just going to be wonderful.
Well, friend, stay with us. We have more to come.
Acts 4:12 reads, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved."
You know, and us as the anchors, we know that that's important, that people understand that He is the reason. So we try and keep in the forefront of our mind that we stay anchored in the presence of God. for those people out there who are sailing the seas of life and tossed about with the storms, that they may reach out and grab hold of the anchor, that God may steady their boat.
We're back with Bernice and friend. If you have diabetes, you're going to want to listen to this next miracle, because Bernice received a wonderful miracle for diabetes. Can you tell us about that miracle, Bernice?
I certainly can. I was diagnosed with diabetes for about 10 years. I had diabetes and I suffered with that. I was on 2 insulins and also medication. And the thing about it was the A1C, the blood sugar level, would be up to like 300. It was very high, you know. Every time I tested, it was high, 300.
Did you have to test every day or?
Yeah, I was told to test at least twice a day or whatever.
So it was inconvenience, you know, you had to do that and, you know, how did you receive your miracle?
Well, the ministers here, yourself and Reverend Markner, you know, and I went for prayer and for tests. The tests were done for the A1C. And when I came back, the test results showed that the A1C level was normal.
You know? Were you surprised when he gave you the results?
The doctor was not only surprised, she was astonished at that, because she had been working with me trying to get it down, you know, through the pills and
the insulin?
The insulin, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, Bernice, you said it was at 300. What's normal? Do you know?
What's the normal range? I believe it's like 140 is the normal range.
So it was like double then. And so it came down a lot.
Yeah, it was. It was very much so.
So after you got the results, what happened next? Did the doctor take you off of all your medications?
I was taking off the insulin. I didn't have to take the insulin anymore. Mm-hmm. So I was happy about that, because no one liked giving themselves shots. Mm-hmm. And I was one of those persons, I didn't like needles anyway. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
Yeah, I think I would have a hard time doing that myself, trying to give myself a shot. So uh-huh. That's
the range,
bondage.
I'm sorry, mm-hmm. The range of the blood sugar level, I'm not quite sure. It's 130, 150, somewhere in there. But mine's, as I said, was 300, and that was over.
Right. You know. You said consistently it was always over.
It was always high. Exactly.
Uh-huh. So you knew for sure the Lord had given you a fantastic uh-huh. miracle uh-huh. because nothing had changed. You were
exactly.
still giving yourself the insulin and yeah. and the medication. And then after prayer,
yes.
it was normal.
Well, the Lord said, believers shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And I thank God for my miracle. I give him all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for moving for me for that.
And just think of the expense you're saving now, because you didn't have to pay for that medicine. And
insulin, it's very, very expensive, yes.
So how long have you been free from diabetes?
Oh, my goodness. Quite some time now. Quite some time.
So it's been years.
It's been years since I was diagnosed with that disease also.
Praise God. That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. Now, you had a situation in your family that happened with your son. Can you share that story with us?
Yes. It was back in 2012, and my son was... He was on his way home on his bike, and he was hit by a hit-and-run accident occurred. And I didn't know this. I don't know who it was that called me to let me know that this accident had occurred, but they did call me. It was at midnight almost, and I had no way to get to him. And anyone with children, they know that when tragedy strikes, you know, your heart just, you know. But I looked to the Lord, you know, I just started praying, because there was no one I could call to get to him after they told me that he was in this accident and they were, you know, he was being transported to the hospital or whatever. I didn't have no way to get to him.
So he was on a bicycle and someone ran into him.
They hit.
And they drove off.
And just drove off and left him there.
How old was your son at the time?
He must have been in his 30s.
His 30s.
You know, yes, mm-hmm. uh-huh. Yes, he was.
And was he serving the Lord at the time, Bernice?
No, he wasn't saved. He was not saved at that particular time.
So like you said earlier, if you die in your sins, you'd go to hell.
And that really hit me really hard because I love him and I didn't want him to die and go to hell. And I still don't, you know.
Right.
I don't want anyone to die and go to hell, of course. But I prayed and I walked the floor, you know. I said, Lord, if there's any way possible that you can get someone to him, to help him, I pray that you would, you know, get him help that he needs, you know, and get me so I can see him. I wanted to see, you know, what condition he was in, because at that time I didn't know. I didn't know what hospital he was in. They just told me that he was having a hit and run accident, you know.
So you were really pulling on God.
Yes.
Not only for mm-hmm. his life, but mm-hmm. for his soul, because mm-hmm. you knew
okay.
that and he wasn't serving the Lord at the time.
Exactly. I had to pull on the Lord. There was no one else I could pull on. Of course, I did contact Reverend Ainsley, and he and others prayed with me, you know, for his, you know, his miracle or his healing, and God moved. He was left with he had a neck injury. The discs were dislocated. He had to wear what's called a halo. It just stabilized the neck.
I remember visiting him.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a cage. It's literally a metal cage that goes around, and it has like, I guess I don't want to say screws or pins or something that holds his.
They were
pins. And he couldn't move. He just had it look. No. I mean, it looked extremely uncomfortable.
It really did from looking at it. But I thank God for the technology, medical science, you know. But God gave the miracle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how did he move for him?
Well, like I said, you know, his neck had to be stabilized because the discs were dislocated. It was through prayer. Reverend Ainsley praying and ministers praying. And of course, people knew about it. I'm sure they did pray also. And I just give God all the honor and all the glory belong to him, because if it had not been for that, you know, he wouldn't have made it. God gave him a miracle. Reverend Ainsley, I thank him today, and I thank the ministers today at Grace Cathedral for praying for my son. He received that miracle, and Reverend Ainsley wrote me a letter explaining to me that, you know, it was, in fact, a miracle that he received. And he's doing okay today, medically,
praise God.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Yeah, because yes. He could be a cripple today.
Yeah, he could be paralyzed. He could have been paralyzed.
He could have been a quadriplegic.
Yes, mm-hmm. He could have. Yes.
Praise God, there's power in prayer.
Yeah.
So do you have any other miracles you'd like to share with us, Bernice?
Well, through prayer, the prayer line, and the ministers here at Grace Cathedral praying for me, I received miracles. I was diagnosed with what's called H. pylori. It is a bacteria that affects the stomach, you know, bacterium negative in the stomach, you know, and there's different symptoms associated with it, of course. And I lost my appetite. I couldn't sleep, insomnia, just different, you know, it was just horrible. But God gave me a miracle for that, you know.
And, was it painful?
Discomfort, a lot of discomfort, because there's a lot of, there's constipations, there's different things mm-hmm. that goes on, you know. It was just, and
were the doctors able to help you?
Yes, the doctor, you know, medical science, you know, they can give you medicine, but they didn't have the cure. I received prayer, and of course, there's healing in medicine also. God put that there also. Mm-hmm. So they gave me antibiotics. I must have been on antibiotics for about 3 months. I did go for prayer. Reverend Markman prayed for me. And the miracle power went into my body and healed me of that. So I'm free of that today. I give God,
God
all the glory and all the praise for that.
That's wonderful.
So if anyone need a miracle, you know, you can get prayer for it here, you know, at Grace Cathedral. Call the prayer line, you know, and receive prayer.
Yes, faith in God heals mm-hmm. us sick.
Yes.
Do you have another miracle you'd like to share?
Yes, another miracle I received was for anemia. And that is when the blood in your body, you know, the red blood cells does not carry enough oxygen in your body to different parts of the body. And I suffer from that also. And again, I received prayer and God moved for that. And I'm free of that today.
Now you taught in the Sunday school, right?
So yes, about 4 years, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and when you were teaching the kids, I mean, you know, how did the kids respond to you? Did you just love it or how, you know, what was
I loved
on?
It, you know.
And what age did you teach?
I was assigned an 8-year-old classroom.
Well, we're so glad that you've been a part of the Sunday school and were able to influence many of the children. Because like you didn't grow up really knowing the truth.
No, I didn't.
And then for the Lord to make a way for you to be such a blessing to children and to teach them the truth at a young age, that's so important. And the truth is what sets people free. And that's what the Lord did for your life. Mm-hmm. And now you're going forth and sharing, you know, what God has done for you and helping people find Christ. And I just think that's a beautiful thing. But Bernice, we have to take another quick break here. So friend, stay with us. We're gonna be right back.
Our Grace family is supported by viewers like you. Your donation is greatly appreciated. Your financial gift ensures that this faith-building program can continue to be a blessing to you and your family, and to many others just like you.
Welcome back, and we want to thank you, Bernice, for being on the show today. You were such a pleasure, and all the wonderful miracles that God gave you. It's just wonderful. And friend, we had a lady from Thornton, West Virginia, testify that she had diabetes and her doctor wanted her to start insulin, but instead she decided to come and get prayer. And afterwards she went back to the doctor and she was completely healed. Friend, you can receive a miracle as well.
Yes, just come and be with us in the services. We'd love to have you. And just remember, God made you. He can heal you. God bless you.
If you are encouraged or blessed by today's program, let us know. We would love to hear from you. You can email us at ourgracefamily@thegracecathedral.org or write to us. This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angley Ministries.